Okay. Well, welcome to our webinar today. First of all, from my side, thank you very much for taking the time out of your busy schedule to be with us today. We really appreciate your support and interest. I see most of the people on today's webinar, I do recognize the names and I know you people. There's some one or two new names out there. Let me introduce myself. My name is Sean van den Berg. I head up client education here at PSG Wealth. The format as such is that any questions you have, just type in the question box and I'll be able to answer the questions hopefully through the presentation, but also near the end of the presentation, there's a slot for questions. This presentation is being recorded, so I'll be sending you the PDF of the PowerPoint as well as the recording, hopefully by Friday the latest. Okay, so it looks like everybody's in. So let's kick off and get going. So the title of today's webinar is A Locally Diversified Investment Strategy. So that is the main title, but as a subtitle, are you a value growth or momentum investor? The whole idea of, I think the main objective of today's presentation is why not incorporate or blend all three strategies into a long-term investment or buy and hold a share portfolio. And that is the focus of today's presentation. So my objective of this webinar, the results I want for you, or the my outcome for you guys today, is for you to know how you can create an investment strategy that suits your needs, your investment objectives, number one, and number two, also to provide you options, so you can make better, well-informed investment decisions and ultimately have peace of mind and what I call sleep well at night. Okay, so clock everybody's in. So let's kick off like we do with every webinar with a quote, and this one's again from Warren Buffett, and we're going to be talking about diversification. So according to Warren Buffett, why diversification is only required when investors do not understand what they are doing. In other words, if you diversify too much, you might not lose much, but you won't gain much either. So that is the gist of today's presentation. So first of all, before we really get into the nitty-gritty, let me just ask you, what is diversification? Now, we've all heard of the financial experts expounding on the benefits of diversification. And while that's not just a small talk, a personal share portfolio must be diversified to some degree. And the whole idea there is to lessen the inherent risk of holding only one share or one kind of share, for example, just gold shares. So, for example, if you've only got one share, the chance of you losing money is 100% if that share price drops. If you've got two shares, your chances or the risk drops down to 50%, three shares, 33%, and so it goes on. Now, my philosophy always with a share portfolio was to spread the risk. And how we do that, we spread it between, I always like to have a share portfolio between 8 and 12 shares. So the minimum, if you've got 12 shares in your portfolio, each share, the chances are if that share drops, is only going to have a small impact on the total portfolio, like 8%, 8.3% impact, call it that. So the whole idea is to structure a portfolio between 8 and 12 different shares and between three and five different sectors. So you don't have all your shares in gold stocks or all your shares in telecommunications, for example. So that's what I mean by diversification. So when we talk about diversification in the share portfolio, we're referring to the investor trying to, as I say, reduce the exposure, his exposure to risk. And by that, as I said just now, is to invest in various shares or companies across various sectors or different sectors and industries. So diversifying, as I say, the whole idea here is to reduce both risk and volatility. But saying that, if you talk to any investment professional, they'll say that diversification is no guarantee against loss, but it is a prudent strategy still. So especially if you adopt a long-term view, long-term investment goal as such. So the whole idea, and I use this analogy, imagine a crocodile with jaws open. If some of your shares will come down in your portfolio and other shares will go up. So is that crossing over, that crocodile jaws? So the whole idea is to create a share portfolio with shares that have a low correlation to each other. So in other words, different shares or different industries or different sectors don't move up and down at the same time, number one, and number two, at the same rate. So, you know, some sectors you will find that, you know, as I say, what you lose in the swings, you make up for the roundabouts. But your objective is to, you know, yes, we want to outperform the market. So the idea is that, yes, in the beginning, diversification is relevant. But once you've got your feet wet and you've built, I always say you build a share portfolio. You adjust your, you know, once you've got your feet wet, you adjust your portfolio accordingly, and then you make start making bigger bets. In other words, you start adding to the stocks in your portfolio. Okay, you add to a winning position. So that is just a quick introduction to what I mean by diversification. And that's where a lot of the focus will be on today, but from a different angle when I say diversification. So what is the current situation for a lot of people? We can take it to the other extreme. And when I say the other extreme, you know, the investors that tend to be over-diversified. You know, it's not just having a share portfolio that contains five shares that are performing fantastic, but then you also got 45 stocks that are not doing well. So, you know, your overall portfolio, the performance has been watered down, and you're not realizing the gains from your best stock selection. So the question today, how do you maintain appropriate balance? So on the one side, yes, you want to reduce your overall level of risk, but also, you know, you want to be in a situation where you're reducing your potential level of capital gains, the rewards you get on that side. So the idea here is to, you know, have a concentrated portfolio. I guess I said just like between 8 and 12 different shares. That's how I like to have it. I read a book years ago from Peter Lynch. He wrote a book called What Happened on Wall Street. And he was talking about having five good quality stocks in the portfolio. And obviously, you have a big a weighting in each one of those shares. And the idea is that, you know, instead of putting all your eggs in one basket, you know, you want to spread the risk. His philosophy was put all your eggs in one basket, five stocks, but watch that basket very, very carefully. So that's another way of looking at it. But my goal today, okay, you want to be concentrated in a few different sectors or a few different shares that have the potential to substantially outperform the overall market, number one. Number two, a more concentrated portfolio also enables you as an investor to focus on a more manageable group of quality stocks. You know, the last 2-3 weeks, we've been talking about quality in our presentations and things like that. So I'm just adding to that today. So the current position for a lot of people, and I think this is where the market volatility, we've been talking about volatility also over the last few weeks. A lot of people in the situation now, you know, what direction shall I go? You know, there's a lot of uncertainty. Shall I add to my mutual funds? I was talking to you, a person at one of our seminars last week in Joburg. He's sitting on a lot of cash, waiting for the market to correct and for buying opportunities. But what happens if that buying opportunities in the markets don't pull back? Yes, we can look at the states, they're overvalued, our market's moving sideways. But you know, if you wait too long for the correction, you know, you're wasting opportunities there. That's on one side. The second thing is obviously what asset class. You know, we talk about, I talk about the four asset classes. We talk about paper assets. That's all the shares, commodities, I mean, the shares, unit trusts, anything to do with paper. That's one asset class. I talk about physical property, business, and commodities. So that's another thing for a lot of people to decide, is that spread over various asset classes. And then, you know, having all eggs in one basket, you know, the risk there, if you have, for example, too many gold shares. Yes, the gold stocks have pulled back on some profit taking now. But what happens if you're too much involved with banking stocks? You've got too many banking stocks in your portfolio. The one banking stock not falls over, this is where well, I get the idea of the domino, this domino effect. One banking stock pulls back, usually the whole banking sector falls back, and that means most of your financial shares will pull back. So that's a broad, call it a current situation for a lot of investors. So what's the ideal situation? And the ideal situation, you know, you're going to be in a situation where, you know, you're aiming for a modest amount of diversity, but also your primary focus, not only on diversification, but on selecting high quality investments, but based on your preferred investment strategy. And that could be value investing, growth investing, or investing for income, but also your personal risk tolerance, as well as your overall investment goals. In other words, your term horizon. So when I talk about that, and we just had the Olympics now in Rio, So yeah, I've used this little analogy of hurdling. So the idea here is that just reinforcing the point is that you wanna get over the hurdles. You wanna win the race. So having a diversified investment strategy within a diversified portfolio, as I say, I'm reinforcing the point here. My goal ultimately is still that exponential growth. So the idea is to put together a portfolio designed to meet the best need, your needs as such. So how do we get there? And it's a blend. Now we talk about stock picking strategies. We talk about value investing, growth investing, or GARP investing, and investing for dividends. So it's a blend. Now, right in the beginning, we spoke about momentum investing. Now, heads up, first of all, I believe momentum investing is a trading strategy. As an investor, I talk about buying and holding. With momentum investing, remember that the main emphasis there is capitalizing on the trend continuing upwards. But most of the time, you're buying into stocks that are already, call it, overvalued. So to me, as I say, momentum investing is more of a trading strategy. That's my personal opinion, because remember, it's a buy and sell strategy, that's more short term, where I look at value investing as more long term. So I'm going to be talking about these three investment strategies today: value investing, GARP investing, or growth at a reasonable price, and investing for dividends. Okay, so I hope I haven't offended anybody. Well, they were expecting a presentation on momentum investing. By the way, I did a webinar a few months ago on momentum investing. So those of you that are more focused on momentum investing, you're welcome to drop me an email. I'm glad you sent the presentation if you missed it. Okay, so we're talking about blending or incorporating all three strategies, the three main strategies into one share portfolio. So let's kick off with what is value investing. Now, a lot of our research on the PhD Wealth website is skewed towards value investing, but the main idea here is a value investor. It's an investment style that focuses on buying a stock or a share that is undervalued according to fundamental analysis. So obviously there's fundamental financial ratios, fundamental criteria. But my goal here is to buy these undervalued shares and then hold those shares until they reach the true value. In other words, value investors is presumed to be, the stocks are presumed to be trading at a discount to the true value. I always say value investors is a bargain hunter. You're looking for bargains, for share that's trading below its intrinsic value. But saying that, we get two schools of thought when we talk about value investing. The interpretation can differ from investor to investor. One group of investors will be focusing on or observing the past and present fundamentals without considering much about the future growth. That's one group. The other group will be focusing their strategies mainly on estimating what is the future growth potential, as well as obviously looking at forward-looking fundamentals. Well, despite these two differences, value investing, the concept, we're always looking to buy shares that are trading less than it's worth. That is what we talk about as a value investor. So again, on our PSG website, there are various tools that help you scan the market, and I'll show you on the next slides, looking for objective criteria. So it's a big time saver to help you build your initial watch list, and from your watch list, obviously buying shares for a share portfolio, and that's how you build a portfolio. Okay, so on our website, as I say, is a starting point. Once you've logged in, under research, there's a button called search. Now I'm using I call them shortcuts or the defaults. I'm looking for stocks that are undervalued and they're also quality. So these are criteria where the quality rating is above 70% and the PEG ratio, and I'll talk about PEG ratio just now in a bit more detail, is about 35% and below 75%. So there's my criteria. I'm looking for shares that are meeting that criteria. You can see all of them are green, and according to our legend here, you can see it's undervalued. So that's the main focus here. By the way, if you click on that's the value tab, and you click on the quality tab, you'll see the quality rating, as I say, above 70%. Now, out of these stocks, and I'm just highlighting again, we spoke about them in last week's webinar. I'm just being consistent and continuing on the same trend. Last week, we spoke about Sasol and Truworths, and since then, yes, Truworths' price has come back. Investor didn't really like the trading update, missed the expectations, but it's still a good quality stock and it's still undervalued. So I still like Ellis stock a lot. You can see Sasol and Truworths, the price earnings multiple relative to the average of the market, which is about 19, 20. These guys are undervalued. Price NAV, Sasol's trading at a slight premium, 10% premium. But let's look at the dividend yields, 4.6% and 5.3%. They're good stocks. They're manageable risk, and you can see there's a quality rating. Okay, this was until Monday when I did this, when I created this presentation. You can see this is a graph of Sasol, and that's a graph of Truworths over the last. This is a weekly chart to show you the performance. Okay, so that's the idea, is to start going through that list. If I go back here. And then choosing some shares, you know, I'll be looking at PE, I'll be looking at PEG, I'll be looking at all these different criteria and then honing it down to a more manageable list and by creating a watch list. Okay. So that's one way of creating, adding shares into your initial portfolio. Then we talk about GARP, growth at a reasonable price. Now, just understand, we talk about growth investing and we talk about GARP. They're two different strategies. Growth investing, we're focusing on companies growing very far. Growing very fast, but we're not taking consideration valuation. I like to use GARP, growth at reasonable price. Came back to Peter Lynch, he was a GARP investor. But GARP investing identifies companies that display a very specific characteristics, but on an individual basis. So we're looking at stocks that are not just purely value on the one side or purely growth. It's a combination of the two. So yes, we're concerned about growth prospects, but also we're looking at positive earnings numbers. We're looking at earnings projections, but also very, very importantly, we're also preferring safer, more realistic earnings growth. Not companies that are shooting the lights out and obviously the price has gone through the roof and valuation's gone out of the window. So, you know, growth investing, as I say, the main focus is there on capital appreciation. So the share price is running like crazy. We're looking for companies that have signs of above average growth. That'll be, from a growth point of view, the headline is growth forecast. The average of them, well, great stocks will be 15% plus. These companies are growing much more than that. But most of these stocks you see from the price will be very expensive. That'll be based on the price of PE multiple as well as the price NAV. So, you know, what you want to do is obviously compare apples with apples. You want to compare the particular company you're looking at to its peers or to the industry and then to the overall market. Okay, so GARP investing avoids the extremes. Okay, so this is what it looks like on our website. You'll find there's a link here called growth at a reasonable price. So we're not only looking at PEG ratios now, we're looking at HEPS. Headline earnings per share growth forecast, and you can see that's a criteria, yeah. And by the way, as I say, this is the default. You can go select your own criteria based on these 12 different columns. I suggest this as a starting point. But out of this list, what stocks would I like? I'm looking at Netcare. I like Netcare, and I like Sun International. Sun International is involved with this new casino here in Menland. They're ahead of 6 weeks ahead of schedule. But they're great companies. And so you can see the growth, the growing earnings by 18% plus. Dividend yield not so hectic. Obviously, the share price has gone up, so obviously the yield will go down. But it's still good quality. They're both good quality companies. So this is how you'd blend a growth stock into a portfolio. Okay. And then the third strategy is what we call investing for dividend. How do you identify dividend paying companies? So first of all, you'll find that these companies pay a relatively high and regular dividend, number one. Number two, obviously when you're looking at this, when I say regular, you'll be looking at its past, its long history, its track record and things like that. And most of the time you'll find it's a quality, mature company. It's reached a certain size. It can no longer sustain its previous high level of growth. I remember years ago with MTN. MTN was a serious growth company. They were growing by acquisitions. The dividend yield was very, very low. But now it's become a more mature company, and it's starting to pay out more and more dividends. So those are the kind of things you're looking at. So it all depends on what I say there's a dividend policy and things like that. So the problem is a lot of people just look at dividend yields. You know, the average of the market is between 0.5 and say 3%. The challenge is that if you just want to live on dividends alone, you need a large amount of money, a lot of capital to generate a meaningful income. So R1 million share portfolio giving you an average of 3% dividend yield, you're going to get about R30,000 in dividend income. And obviously, you have to pay dividend withholding tax on that of 15%. So 15% on your 30,000 is about 4.5. You'd be left with, what's that, 25, 25,500 for the year divided by 12. That's your income. But saying that, you know, obviously, you want to go for higher yields, a company's paying higher. So, yeah, you build a portfolio. But still, one of the safest withdrawal rates is because you're not touching your capital. You're not touching your principal amount, and that's, you're living off the dividends. Okay, so the question is that I like to have a blend of all these in my portfolio. So what's important to understand is that dividend yield. You know, we're looking at, not only looking at it in rand terms, what I just did now, converted back into rands, but looking at, we're going to compare apples of apples to get a dividend yield. By the way, the dividend yield is the annual dividend per share divided by the current share price. That's a percentage. So this is where you can compare what one share to another share of different sizes. But average shares, as I say, generate between 2 and 3%. You want to go above average, between 5 and 6%. Now on our website, you can click on value, and then obviously click on that. So before you get to that, is investing for dividend income. That's the shortcut you're getting to. There's a long list here. So this is looking at dividend yield. You see down this list here, and again, you can see Sasol's in there. I like Sasol. And if you click on the other tab, on the quality tab, and this is where that the formula comes in, I'm looking at the dividend as a percentage of my profits. Now, the average of the market, they pay out about a third, you know, of dividends to shareholders. So I'm looking for companies paying out more than that. But also the quality rating is still very important, and also looking at valuation. So again, on this list, you see there's quite a nice long list. Again, I'm highlighting Sasol for 4.6% as a great dividend yield, and I saw today's business day. They're maintaining the dividend despite what's happening in the States. The costs have gone up with one of their crackers there. What's it? Lake Charles. So, but they're maintaining the dividend. That's why I like Sasol. They're consistent. But the reason why I only got one stock here, you'll find that the companies that are true dividend paying companies are mostly your banks and your life insurance companies. On our website, you'll find a link called recommendation, and there's our top 10 investing for dividends list. I've just taken the top six to highlight for you. MMI is insurance company, bank, Barclays Africa, Liberty Insurance Company, Clientele Insurance Company, Nedbank. But look at the dividend yields. Okay, so if you go down, if you know, if you go back to that list I showed you just now, there are a lot of listed property companies here. Okay, and you'll find that there are some small cap stocks. I like to go with companies that are big, mature companies, been around for a long time. They are safe. They will maintain their dividend yield, and that's why I'm highlighting this for you guys. So I like to have a blend of all these shares in my portfolio, good quality stocks. Undervalued, profitable, manageable risk, and they're paying out good dividends. Okay, so I hope that made sense to you. So, what are the benefits of this strategy? So, there's pros and cons. There's benefits and there's drawdowns. So, I can look at all three of them. As a value investor, the benefit here is that, remember, the share price is down already. Remember, Warren Buffett says, "Be fearful when everyone else is greedy, and be greedy when everyone else is fearful." So, undervalued stocks have fallen already. The advantage of that, you're purchasing shares with a high margin of safety. For them to drop any further, it's very small. Okay, I'll have a caveat to that. That's now. That's number one. Number two, you're investing against the herd. Everybody else is selling, you're buying. So you're ignoring the hot tips that can impair your judgment. And number two, no, sorry, number three, over the long term, I'm talking 20-year period, value investing has consistently outperformed other kinds of investment strategies. But saying that, you know, I'm going to contradict myself. You can be in a situation where you can get into what I call a value trap, where cheap shares just carry on keeping going cheaper in a downward market. So that's why it's important to look at valuation and quality. And I've harped on this in the last few webinars. Number two, intrinsic value is subjective. Now, what is the true value of a company? Two investors can look at the same company. They'll come to two different conclusions about the value of a company. So that is subjective. We do use rule of thumb criteria on our website, put you into that ballpark regarding valuation, but it helps you to get into or highlight opportunities for you. Value investing, however, in the short term, sometimes growth investing can do much better. And I say short term and on an annual basis. So there's pros and cons, and there are much more benefits and drawbacks if you had to go look further onto on the website, on the internet. Growth investing or GARP investing, successful investments may appreciate much faster than the overall market. That's why you want to have those kickers in your portfolio, not only the value stocks, you want to have some growth stocks in your portfolio, just by the value, by the definition of growth investing. Number two, the investment selection is focused on attractive companies with above average growth in earnings as well as in revenue. Thirdly, you know, this is where you get the, I always say you get the sexy stocks. Those companies that are cutting edge industries, they're growing rapidly and evolving very quickly. And they're exciting to watch the growth. I remember, as I say, a few years ago with MTN, as they were doing that, growing by acquisition into Africa, etc. The drawbacks, obviously, growth investing comes with higher risk and higher volatility. That's why you want to smooth it out with other kinds of stocks in your portfolio. Dividends, growth stocks, as I mentioned with MTN just now, usually find that they reinvest back into the business for future growth expansion. So you find that dividends are very uncommon with a lot of the growth companies, especially a newer company. And then obviously, it could be time intensive to validate the credibility of the various growth projection estimates of the growth stocks. And then lastly, investing for dividends, the main objective here, remember, I'm looking at generating passive income. So dividend shares do provide that steady source of income, be it on a quarterly basis or biannual. Doesn't take a lot of work. You just have those stocks in your portfolio and you have a growth in that income on a yearly basis. So the idea is also that you take advantage of compounding. You know, when you use your dividends to purchase additional shares, you'll earn more money. So this is when your money makes money for you. Money babies, as I heard once upon a time. And then thirdly, invest once and you profit twice. So yes, you're getting it, investing in companies that are financially stable and reliable, but also you find that the share price, because the investors are being rewarded, they buy into the shares and obviously the share price goes up. The drawbacks is the dividend policy. The dividend policy can change. And I remember a few years ago when Anglo passed the dividend, the share price dropped. So this is what happens when companies want to hold more money back, paying out to shareholders because I want to expand my business, whatever the case might be. That can shock the system. There's no guarantees that obviously companies will carry on paying dividends. So it's there's a risk there. But high dividend-paying companies, there are risks. There's a balancing act. On the one side, you want to attract and keep investors, but also you want to be able to maintain earnings for future expansion. So it's a little balancing act. You want to see the company paying out all its dividends. What about future growth? You find that dividend-paying companies, the share price appreciation is slightly slower than growth stocks, number one. And number two, that you find that the share price can still drop irrespective if dividends are paid or not. So those are some of the risks involved. So what does this all mean? The main objective today is for you to blend an investment strategy. I'm always looking for what I call the ideal share. Shares that meet my criteria. If I had a magic wand, what kind of shares would I like to invest in? So you don't find this all the time. Once in a while, you do find it. I'm looking for shares just from a fundamental point of view. They're undervalued, profitable, have great growth prospects, the dividend yield is above average. It's got manageable risk from cash flow point of view as well as interest cover, and it's a good quality stock. That's the ideal share I'm looking at from a fundamental point of view. I always say what share to buy. Those are the criteria I'm looking for. Another side of the coin, obviously, when to buy and when to sell. Okay. So let's see what kind of questions you guys have. Uh, Eleanor, long question, yeah. Would you invest in stocks where the dividend is less than bank interest and where there is little or no capital growth in a sideways market at the moment? Whew. Okay. So the dividend yield for most of the market is below the interest rate you're getting in the bank. Yes, I agree with that. Ideally, I want to be buying into companies where the capital growth is there too. So, that might be one or two little stocks. No, it won't be your whole portfolio anymore, but you're still getting the dividend growth. Okay, Milan, what is the PE again? PE is what they say, the price earnings multiple. It's the earnings divided by the current share price. Sorry, the other way around. What did I say now? The EPS. No, the other way around. The price as a percentage of the as a ratio to earnings. That'd be the price earnings multiple. What did you prefer? To take 26 years to recover your money out of the market, or 10 years to recover the money out of the market? So when you're looking at PE ratios, we prefer to look at a low PE ratio. So I hope that answers your question. HEP stands for headline earnings per share. Earnings per share is a profit divided by the number of shares in issue. Headline earnings per share is a ratio we use here in South Africa. It's the top of the income statement that if there's any extraordinary items, we add it back at the end. But headline earnings per share is just the profit as divided by the number of shares in issue. So you don't compare one share to another share, you look at the HEPs. Okay, I hope that answers your question. Is the ideal mix between quality, value, and income in a portfolio? The ideal mix. As I say, you want to blend. The way I like it, to look at it, I like to have between 8 and 12 different stocks in my portfolio, and that's spread between large caps, mid caps, and small caps. But when I look at small caps, obviously risk management is very important. So it's not an ideal mix. I'm not 100% sure what you mean by that, Dragon. The whole idea is that you're spreading the strategy out by finding the best value stocks, the best growth stocks that meet your criteria. Okay, I hope it answers your question too. There's a qu question from Quirus from Jaarsveld. When taking a value investing approach, in other words, keeping shares for a long time, what is the ideal stop loss percentage to use when looking at a 25 to 50 to 20-year investment period? Great question. I personally don't use a stop loss in a share investment portfolio. I use stop loss more for trading. The way I manage risk is from a diversification, from a long point of view, number one. Number two, if I find that the stock is overvalued based on a PEG ratio and things like that, it becomes overvalued, I would then put a 20% stop loss on a stock. So, overvalued stock can still go up higher. But if it does drop 20% from there, I'll be getting out. That's one side of the coin. But the other side of the coin, I would only sell the stock. Buy and hold shares. This is again the way I look at my portfolio. I would only sell a share in my portfolio if my original decision for buying a share has changed. Number one, the fundamentals are changing. In other words, that the growth prospects have slowed down drastically and forecast to carry on that for a number of years. That's the one side, growth. Another side of the coin is obviously health. If I see the quality of the balance sheet is deteriorating. Those kind of things all make me second guess the shares in my portfolio. So, Quivers, I hope that answers your question. I'd rather use a stop loss to say a trading portfolio. Okay, so that's all the questions. Cool. I hope it. Okay, let me just go on to. Let's go on to the next slide. So, what I want you to gain from this presentation, ask yourself, are you a value, a growth, or an income investor? I always joke when I do seminars, I say to people, who are the investors, buy and hold investors, and the hands go up, and who are the traders, and the hands go up. I said, who's both? And some of the hands go up, and I say, who's not sure? Same thing here. You want to be in a situation where you're both, you're both investor and a trader, two separate accounts, but in this situation, in one portfolio, this is my suggestion today, is have a blended approach, not just having only a value portfolio or having a growth portfolio, but blending it. So it's one way to, as I say, to manage risk, but also to focus on higher probability stocks that are going to go up. So again, between 8 and 12 different shares, 3 to 5 different sectors, and as I say, that blended portfolio, focusing on value, growth, and income all together. Okay, so hopefully guys made sense to you guys. So what are the next steps? You can go, if you haven't got a share portfolio of us yet, please go register and open up an account with us. You'll also have access to our research tools, and all these things is a big time saver to help you make a more informed investment decision. So this presentation will be sent out hopefully by the latest by Friday. But any questions you guys have, you're welcome to contact our sales guys. There's the contact details. Next week, we're discussing how to leverage off your own share portfolio. And the week after that, what to do when you're changing jobs. So hopefully by next week, I'll have the rest of the webinars up until the end of October. So you guys can also see what's available. Okay, so from my side, guys, thanks a lot for being on this webinar again. Thanks for your support. I really appreciate it. We had a good turnout today. Okay, so enjoy the rest of your week. Enjoy the rest of your day. Until next week, all the best. Bye for now.